Hi, I'm Matt Lauer.
And I'm Jill Rappaport. PM Magazine and Carol Burnett and Friends will not be seen this evening so that Channel 5 may present Countdown to Live Aid.
A one-hour special about the most exciting global concert in music history. Now, be a part of the big event. It starts here on Channel 5 tomorrow morning, live at 7 a.m. and goes until 6 p.m. And don't forget that we'll be back again on Monday night.
Since Woodstock have so many musicians gathered together, and never for such a good cause.
It should be the biggest thing since the parting of the Red Sea, if they want, if that's what it takes to get the thing, because we're trying to save some people here.
And not since the birth of our nation have Philadelphia and London been the centers of such international attention. The world will be watching as the City of Brotherly Love plays co-host to an event guaranteed to rock the world. Live Aid, a 24-hour musical extravaganza to benefit the famine victims of Africa. Join us for a one-hour special as we count down to the concert of the century. You'll hear from the stars who'll make it shine.
I am about people, and I'm about doing whatever I can to help in any situation. And
you know, I mean, I think it's going to be a great event, but I think it's really going above everybody's heads.
If I can save two or three people, we'll have done a good job.
And discover how one man's dream became a reality.
The concert is not the final culmination by any means, but I think it is the ultimate expression that pop music can make.
From London to Philadelphia, join Ray Murray, Nancy Glass, and Judy Barton as they explore the issue behind the event.
One of the most serious questions that people have asked is, why, if we knew the famine was coming as early as 1982, and we did we not respond earlier?
The stage is set, and the world is waiting as we tune up with a one-hour star-studded presentation and countdown to the Live Aid World Concert.
You are looking at the largest stage ever built for a single event.
Tomorrow, it will be the site of the biggest rock concert in history.
Hello, everyone. I'm Ray Murray.
And I'm Judy Barton. Welcome to JFK Stadium in Philadelphia and Countdown to Live Aid.
Now, the Live Aid concert will be seen by more than 1 billion people worldwide. And its purpose, of course, is to feed the famine victims of Africa.
But as you know, Ray, Philadelphia is not the only site of a mammoth concert, because simultaneously, there will be a concert at Wembley Stadium in London, where our colleague Nancy Glass is standing by right now.
Well, Ray and Judy, this is Wembley Stadium, and right now it is fairly empty, except for the construction crew putting the finishing touches on the stage right behind me. Tomorrow, it will be crammed with 90,000 fans who have come here to see the Live Aid concert. Tonight, we will be talking with some of the performers involved, among them David Bowie, Adam Ant, members of Dire Straits, Spandau Ballet, and The Who. And those performers tell us they're pretty excited about all of this. Most of them are really looking forward to The Who's reunion and seeing other great performers like Paul McCartney, who we hear is a little nervous about all of this. He has not been in concert now for 7 years, and an estimated audience of 1.5 billion people is pretty nerve-wracking. That's it from here for now.
You know, the Live Aid concert has been called the Woodstock of the 80s, but it really has gotten much bigger than that.
It certainly has.
When you stop to think about 36 acts performing here in Philadelphia, 22 in London, with a total running time of something like 17 hours.
And what's even more amazing is that Phil Collins and maybe even some other artists, after they are finished performing at Wembley Stadium in London, they will hop on a Concorde and fly here to the States to perform here at JFK Stadium.
So why would these celebrities give up so much of their time and so much of their money to perform here at Live Aid? Well, we talked to some of the top names to find out.
We are the world. We are the children. We are the ones to make a brighter day. So let's start giving.
Their faces are familiar, and the song they sang rocked the world to the tune of $50 million in famine relief. But We Are the World was just one of many. The first, called Band Aid, was an idea born from Bob Geldof, a rock star who believed that individuals could make a difference.
From that one idea, you've developed it into this massive cause celebre, where there are 1,000 individual groups suddenly saying, this famine is appalling. We must do something about it.
And now, Geldof's latest inspiration is being billed as the biggest concert of the century, Live Aid. Never before have so many of music's superstars gathered together. Mick Jagger, Tina Turner, Madonna, David Bowie, and Phil Collins. These are only a few of the names scheduled to appear on July 13th in Philadelphia and in London. All of them in an effort to feed those who can't feed themselves.
Before it got full up and they didn't have room for any more, I called and asked to take part in it because when the record got done, and I really was saying, gee, that's the first one of those things that I've missed in years, you know, and I really cared about it. And so when I heard about it, I had our people get in touch with Bill Graham's people and just say, hey, would you like us to do it?
You know, when Bob Geldof first presented the idea, nobody was interested. And suddenly everybody started turning up and everybody, I think, felt guilty. So now, like, everybody's going to do it. You know, it's just a big thing.
You can't do everything, but some things tug a little deeper on your heartstrings. And they just won't let you alone. And you just have to adhere to those. And certainly hunger and Africa in particular for us as black people is very important to us to be a part of this.
Most of these headliners have been scrambling to find supporting musicians for their 20-minute segments. Since they won't have time to rehearse, many acts won't sound as tight as they could. But their harmony is in spirit and their hearts in the right spot. For that matter, so are their pocketbooks. Every one of these performers is paying their own way. For Crosby, Stills, and Nash, that's a $10,000 gesture.
What's the price of saving one child from starvation? We're going to have to pay for our own plane to take us there, drop us off, do our 20 minutes or 15 minutes, whatever it is, and then get out of there and go to a different city in a different state to play a concert that night.
This is not a case of just pop groups acting out of generosity. Pop groups wouldn't be in this position were it not for the fans that buy their records, right? I see this as something very special. Governments of the world, the major governments of the world, could have solved this problem like that several years ago. They chose not to. And what's happened is there's been a movement of people, there's ordinary people, through their favorite performers or whatever, get something going to support the solving of this problem.
Rock stars, the end justifies the means. It doesn't matter if people pay to see them or to help Ethiopia, just as long as they pay. For Boy George, his war on world starvation is a more idealistic one.
War was stupid, and people are stupid, and love means nothing in some strange water.
It's not enough. You know, even the Live Aid thing is not enough. It's really now been made into a big event where people are basically going along to see their favourite rock stars, you know. It's told out in... People aren't really going to see the show to say Ethiopians. I think it's just becoming a great big celebrity event, you know, like We Are the World, the American thing, the English thing. It's becoming so celebrity. I really think that the problem really lies elsewhere.
I'm glad the celebrities... I mean, I'm glad that we're part of it and we should do it. But I also think it's a shame that it's left to people like us to take charge of situations like that. We're not politicians.
Quite unanimously, rock stars have rallied to save the starving. The irony is that although they believe in the Ethiopian cause, their allegiance is closer to home.
I think we should do things not just for Ethiopia. I think we should do things for every place. I mean, there are hungry people in Detroit and Philadelphia and Washington.
And there's also the starving people in Mississippi and Wyoming and in the United States and all in the big cities in the Northeast and all over the country. There are hungry people.
I think to be hungry is just an awful thing anywhere. And I'm hoping that this will be another thing that aids that particular area. But I'm also hoping that this may give us more ideas as to how we can, as just ordinary citizens, solve problems. You know, we have the power.
And it should be done. And I think that's going to be the next mission for most of the artists. I know it is.
That song, Tears Are Not Enough, was part of the Canadian effort for World Hunger. And you know, Ray, celebrities taking on the cause of world hunger as their own personal crusade really isn't new.
Well, Crosby, Stills, and Nash and Kenny Rogers, for example, both ask the people who come to their concerts to bring cans of food with them.
And the people respond beautifully. Do you know, when the list of artists scheduled to perform at Live Aid was first announced, some people expressed concern that there were not enough black names on that list.
And no one has stronger feelings about that issue than the man who first created Band-Aid and then organized the Live Aid concert, rock singer Bob Geldof.
It matters not to me that the people dying are black, white, green, puce, or whatever, or if they're dying in Antarctica or Ireland or Africa or Romania or wherever, they're dying. 130 million human beings are dying. If you're worried about the color of an act on the stage, then I'd suggest that you look inside yourself and wonder what your motivations are and whether you may not be guilty of inverted racism. I don't think anybody else is bothered by it.
Geldof's primary concern about tomorrow's concert is that people will lose sight of its original purpose. Well, we will talk more with this dedicated artist and we'll explore the issue that prompted the Live Aid concert when Countdown to Live Aid continues.
They no longer accept the fact that 130 million have to die on our planet for the most preposterous reason of all in this world of surplus, and that is hunger.
Most of the kids I saw are probably dead by now.
And that is a somber reminder of what Live Aid is all about.
You know, on the west end of JFK Stadium, there is a newly painted sign that reads, Feed the World. Well, that is the message and the reality that jolted Bob Geldof into organizing Live Aid in the first place.
And what few people know is that a few weeks ago, Bob Geldof snuck into Philadelphia to check out the facilities here at JFK Stadium.
And we cornered him in a room that is normally used by the Philadelphia 76ers as their dressing room. And we asked him, why is he doing this?
I'm doing it because I could no longer accept last November seeing another child dying in my sitting room. Which sounds like a trite answer, but it's not. For me, enough was enough. And every night I'd seen it now, and I don't know at what point you say stop. Is it at 10 children or 100 children? What is it?
The rain came pouring down yesterday, and everything is like I washed away. I felt despair come crawling through that fog.
He is hardly a household name in the United States. He and his group, the Boomtown Rats, are far better known throughout Europe. But if there is one person who can take credit for uniting the musical world and creating Live Aid, it is Bob Geldof.
The concert is not the final culmination by any means, but I think it is the ultimate expression that pop music can make. I mean, you've had these guys staying in the studio for a night, but here are the greatest artists of the last 20 years, without a doubt. There, and they're saying, I agree with this, and I'm here. There's nothing else they can do.
This is the song and the musical event that gave birth to Live Aid. Late last year, Geldof convinced several of his well-known friends to form a one-time-only group called Band-Aid. They made a record called Do They Know It's Christmas, which in less than a week sold 5.5 million copies. At the time, he told many of these people he'd be calling them again, asking them to perform in a live summer concert. That is the event that happens tomorrow in London and Philadelphia, the biggest concert of its kind ever anywhere.
And we're saying to more people in more countries than has ever been done on a TV event, including the Olympics, we're saying to them, these people care, and they care a lot, and this is what they care about. And if we can educate people who are not aware of it, as per the Eastern Bloc countries and that, and if we can get their rubles and their dollars and their pounds and their marks, then we can keep millions more alive, and more importantly, we've kept the issue up there. We've suddenly put it in the forefront of their consciences, and politicians ignore that at their peril.
You've called up some of the major rock groups in the world, and you've asked them to take part in this at their expense. What was their reaction?
Some said it's costing us £30,000, you know. But, I mean, some, like, just blown-out concerts. I mean, Eric Clapton was playing Las Vegas, and he said, no, this is where I want to be on that day. Nowhere else. What you've got to remember, and which is the nice thing, is that all these people sitting down like you are in countries that are supposedly not friendly to us are watching exactly the same thing you're watching, are enjoying exactly the same thing you're enjoying. And when they get on that phone and give them money, it's because they have the same emotional feeling you have at that point, in that they no longer accept the fact that 130 million have to die on our planet for the most preposterous reason of all in this world of surplus, and that is hunger.
Of all the organizations working on behalf of African relief, one of the most visible and impassioned efforts has been USA for Africa. Proceeds from album, t-shirt, and video sales so far have raised $50 million. And this June, Marlon Jackson accompanied Harry Belafonte and organizer Ken Cragen as they delivered their first shipment of goods to Africa.
For people that are hungry, it's so polite and so well-mannered. You would think that they would grab, but they sat there patiently, and I would put the tray in front of someone, and the people on either side wouldn't touch the food in the tray until I came to them. And some people said, no, I have enough. And I told them, take more, we have plenty. And one lady described to me that they take very little bites so they can make the food last a long time, because they know the feeling of being hungry again.
USA for Africa arranged to have their supplies airlifted directly to the camps in need. Much of what's been sent by other organizations remains at the ports due to lack of ground transportation, fuel, and poor road surfaces. So as one problem's answered, another's created. But these are logistical problems that can be dealt with and are not nearly as paralyzing as drought.
I think maybe the one bit of good news here is that we're told by the experts that generally a famine has a limited life, and that we think that this famine will last somewhere between 18 and 24 months, and that then the rains will begin again, that agricultural production will gradually increase very slowly and certainly not adequately. But famines don't last forever. Famines come to an end.
Still, good weather does not produce clothing or shelter or farm equipment or hospitals. That takes money and education and especially foresight, without which Africa can't be saved.
Well, if you would like to help in that effort, there is a phone number you can call. It is 1-800-LIVE-AID. Now remember, that phone number is not in effect until tomorrow morning at 7 o'clock Eastern Daylight Time. And later on in the show, we'll be giving you an address to which you can send any kind of donation you would like.
Well, when we come back, we'll talk to some of the celebrities on the London side of the Live Aid concert as Countdown to Live Aid continues.
We watch the show. We watch the stars on videos for hours and hours. We hardly need to use our ears.
Hi, this is Nick Ashford.
And Valerie Simpson. And we're finally going to get a chance
to change the world. I mean, the greatest talent in the world will be a part of this. And just to touch emotionally, musically, and spiritually with these people is just something that, if I didn't work, I would still be there.
I think the sentiments expressed by Teddy Pendergrass are shared by all of the artists who are going to be performing in the Live Aid concert, not just on this side of the Atlantic, but also on the London side. Nancy, how about it?
We are outside Wembley right now, and behind me is the sign that will greet all of the fans who come here tomorrow. Inside, they will see 22 acts and some special performances. In fact, just a couple of days ago, David Bowie got together with Mick Jagger at the spur of the moment. They sang a duet and made a video. That will be seen for the first time tomorrow. It will also be released after the concert, and it will raise more money for Band Aid, something that Bowie and many of the performers we spoke to said they are only too happy to do.
Very easy for me to do it, because I get a certain amount of glory out of it. What's a real hero is the kind of person that lives in a small town and does the same kind of work without any kind of recognition. That's real charity.
The fact that everyone sort of, you know, has seen a common cause, you know, to get together and help other people, then that's great, you know, to actually use their talent for
to actually make money to save people's lives is a pretty fantastic thing.
Music picked from the top of the charts, names we all know, a concert carefully planned to attract the biggest audience ever. But here in London, some of the groups involved in this enormous event began their commitment months ago with what they thought would be a simple video.
I don't think it's ever happened before that so many people have gathered together, you know, in the pop world to actually make a single as one unit and wanted it to be the bigger, you know, more successful than any of their own records.
The fact that you can forget all the competitiveness of the music business, get together and do your best, your very best for somebody else, you know, and that's a great gesture from this business.
What do you think of the idea, though, of having all of these stars together at one time?
Well, I think we'll all be watching each other. That's point one. It's just an event that I doubt if the spirit of it or the event will ever be repeated.
And it is that spirit which has reunited this man with his former band, a group that once vowed never to work together again, The Who.
It was great. I think everyone was just a bit taken back by it all. I mean, it was, we do see each other on the odd occasion, especially John and myself, but it was really weird just seeing all the old faces.
I heard you say something earlier about what it was like to ask somebody like The Who to get together for this.
Yeah, well, I kind of described it as a man being in a room with four of his divorced wives, and he was still paying alimony to all of them, and then expecting them to emerge from the room half an hour later, all friends. It really doesn't happen.
I think the only thing that's the drawback of this is that I hope it doesn't become faddy, because the point of it is that it's not going to stop at the end of this year. It'll have to be an ongoing thing.
We're very grateful to be in a position to give something to such a useful project. I mean, I think it's going to be one of the greatest things that's ever happened, I think, with music.
When I look at a picture of somebody starving to death, a little kid looking at you, something happens inside, and it's because you're a human being, you want to do something about it.
This is the stage where those pop stars will appear. It revolves and it's built in three sections, so while one act is on, another can be setting up. The producer says it also revolves because each act has been given a set amount of time between 17 and 22 minutes. And when the time is up, no matter how big the act is, the set will revolve and they will be off. So what do you think of that, Ray and Judy?
It sounds to me like the modern-day version of Getting the Hook.
Yes, it does. As a matter of fact, the stage here at JFK also revolves for exactly those same reasons. Earlier in the week, we were down here at JFK watching them testing everything to make sure it worked just perfectly. But to give you an idea of the magnitude of that stage behind us, there are 2,000 lights on that stage, and they supply more than 2 million watts worth of power, almost enough to light a small city.
Well, speaking of cities, the big city, the city of Philadelphia, has been revving its motors for this event for almost a month now. And it all began with a press conference at City Hall.
Millions of people from around the world, around the country, will be able to see rock superstars as they perform to aid one of the most worthy causes of this decade.
And with that, this historical city made history once again. Philadelphia will be co-host to the biggest charity ball the world has ever seen. And this will be its ballroom, JFK Stadium. The stage is being set for the concert to end all concerts, Live Aid. Over 300 tons of steel and 4,000 man-hours will go into the building of the stage that will hold the creme de la creme of the rock world.
Wherever there's a Ticketron outlet throughout the country, hopefully you'll be able to get some tickets.
In order to avoid counterfeiting, the sale date of these tickets was the best-kept secret since the Normandy invasion. But shortly after the announcement, the lines had formed. JFK was sold out in a matter of hours.
So when these people are coming in, we need to have kind of an accurate list.
For TVs? Oh, great. Well, are they willing to donate some TVs, too?
Diane Gates and Fred Sanyard are two of the people who work for Worldwide Sports and Entertainment, the company that is producing the concert. They and their co-workers have had to deal with logistics that for most of us would have been a nightmare.
We met with city officials and discussed what some of the needs would be in terms of extra security and transportation routes, accommodation situations.
Meaning hotels.
Laurie, at this point, how do we stand for the nights of July 12th, 13th, and 14th?
We've been very, very good with ABC and MTV.
The concert organizers selected three hotels as co-headquarters. The Embassy Suites is one of them. For managing director Chris Full, the key is preparation.
There's an awful lot of preparation and special activity going in to prepare for the concert.
The Palace Hotel's general manager, James Batt, agrees.
It's our experience in accommodating rock groups, bands, and so on that we have to be prepared for anything.
The Four Seasons has housed celebrities before, but general manager Jim Fitzgibbon says this is different.
Oh, there's no question. I mean, the concentration of them is incredible.
All three hotels are gearing up for the unexpected and the unusual.
Not only did it take us close to 3.5 weeks on the telephone to procure it, but there's only a few bottles left in the United States.
I'd like to request for steak and kidney pie.
150-year-old Grand Marnier, which is fairly rare.
We ordered 3 pounds of foie gras and also 24 tins of beluga caviar, 1 ounce.
Food and drink aren't the only considerations in preparing for Live Aid. Crowd control and security are major concerns, both at the hotels and the stadium.
We'll be using about 400 to 500 personnel on the doors, internally here on the field, backstage.
Those that will present a problem to us, we have always managed to make them understand very politely that, unfortunately, under certain circumstances, due to the fact that our guests come first here, we will do everything we need to do.
Live Aid is being called the Woodstock of the 80s, but Live Aid will stand alone, perhaps forever. Teach.
Well, just as Philadelphia has been preparing for this incredible concert, so have some of the performers and the hosts, and one of them has joined us right now on the set, Grace Slick of Starship. Grace, how does it feel to be involved in Live Aid?
Wonderful. I was talking about it earlier. It's different and probably more exciting than anything I've ever been involved in.
The cause is good, too, I guess.
Yeah, well, most concerts are to benefit, the audience enjoys it and the performers enjoy it and get paid and stick it in their pockets. And this is both. In other words, we enjoy it, we enjoy doing it, the audience enjoys it, and the money goes to some people who need some help. And that usually doesn't happen. And I think one of the things about this that's important is that it can happen now and it can keep happening. We can keep doing it. We can do this once a year. We can do this twice a year. And if governments take any interest, that will get these people all the way out of the hole. We can't make quite as big a dent as we would like to, but if the governments help, that makes the difference.
Well, good luck tomorrow, and thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
All right, when we come back, we'll meet two of the people responsible for televising this incredible event all over the world, and we'll see some of the videos that have already raised millions of dollars for famine relief. The cables stretch forever. The cameras seem innumerable. And there are more things to plug in here than you could possibly imagine. But each little piece of television equipment and each person working on it is vital to beaming the Live Aid concert around the world. This is a TV event like never before. These satellite dishes will send the concert to 169 countries with an estimated audience of 1 billion people.
We're at a point of executing this thing. That's why we're all here. And I'm very honored to have so many talented people here working on this show.
Tony Verna is co-producer of the Live Aid concert. He is no stranger to television. In fact, he's the one who invented the concept of instant replay. Tomorrow, he will oversee a small army of producers, directors, and cameramen. He is the one person who will have to know what's happening even before it happens. But he's also the first to tell you that while TV may be the vehicle, it's the message that's important.
The outcome of a football game has a winner who won an American football game. The outcome of the Derby has a horse that won a certain race. And in a lot of other sports, it's a medal. Here, you're going to feed 130 million starving people. It always feels good. It always feels like this transmission has importance. It also feels good that you're giving solid entertainment. It's not a hype. Look at the names on this show. You know, they're mega. I mean, it's not a hype at all. It's great, great entertainment.
Missing a handheld. There you go. You got it, John. You got it.
TV crews only began planning for Live Aid 1 month ago, and for a project of this magnitude, that is very little time. The man who is helping to coordinate that coverage is Vince Scarza.
It's a monumental project. We've got 15 cameras set up on the show. Logistically, we've got a lot of things happening. We have Dick Clark here doing a show. We're doing a show for the world. We're doing a show for syndicated television, and we're doing a show for MTV. So we're actually creating four shows practically out of this whole event.
I can't wait for it to happen. Can't wait. I love this kind of energy, and I love working with people that have the right spirit.
We have 90,000 people here, you know, 65 or 70,000 at Wembley. But it's that almost 1.5 billion people that this is going to go to. And television is what it's all about right now. And I think it's going to open up other things that are going to happen in the world because of this show, a communication between people.
Well, behind the scenes here at Wembley, promoter Harvey Goldsmith says all the details are being taken care of. He isn't worried one bit. He says tomorrow all that can happen is that a satellite might go down, or an act might not show up, or someone might trip over a cable backstage and knock out all the lights in the stadium. But there wouldn't be a concert if it weren't for a song and a video created around Christmas time by Bob Geldof that inspired more songs and videos, all designed to raise money to feed the world.
Released in Britain and Europe in November of 1984, Do They Know It's Christmas eventually reached the top 10 in West Germany, Italy, the Netherlands, and Australia. In America, its highest chart position was 13th. During its 4 months in circulation, video and album sales have accumulated just under $11 million. By Michael Jackson and Lionel Richie, We Are the World was released March 24th and climbed to number one on the American charts by April 13th. The video came out on the market just 2 weeks ago and is currently the hottest selling video in the country. To date, royalties for USA for Africa have raised $50 million. One big family comes from the heart of Nashville. This past April, 40 country musicians gathered together in their effort to aid world hunger. 50% of the proceeds will be pledged to international hunger, while the other 50% will be donated to fight hunger here in America. We've got to find a way somehow. 'Cause if they ever needed us, they need us now. That the organizers of Live Aid are hoping to raise funds is through the sale of sweatshirts and t-shirts like these. They have a wonderful logo across the front. It's the continent of Africa, but it also looks like a guitar, and the words Live Aid are across the middle. And then, of course, on the back of these sweatshirts and t-shirts, you have the names of all of the performers that are scheduled to appear.
Well, in turn, one of the biggest concerns here is the bootlegging of merchandise like this, because all of the profits from Live Aid memorabilia goes to help famine relief in Africa. When we come back, we'll go over to London and we'll see how that town is preparing for the Live Aid concert.
I complained about being that tired, and then I thought about people in Ethiopia and people who are dying and people who are sick, really sick with cancer and different things. And here I'm complaining about being tired. I said, just shut up and get out there and work, you know, and be glad you have a job.
Well, Patti LaBelle is a native Philadelphian, so she'll be appearing tomorrow night in her hometown on stage at 9 o'clock.
And the whole concert will open here in Philadelphia at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. And promoter Bill Graham told me that when he found out that Prince Charles and Lady Diana were going to be opening up the London portion of the concert, he thought to himself, now, who do we have in the United States that's close to royalty? And he thought and he thought, and he came up with the name Jack Nicholson. So Jack Nicholson will be opening the festivities here tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock, and I guess he's considered our royalty.
Well, Nancy Glass is in a royal spot herself right now. Nance?
Now, if you were coming here to Wembley Stadium to see the concert, you would want a good view. Well, this is the best seat in the house, but it's taken. It's the royal box, and here is where Princess Diana will sit with Prince Charles beside her. But before the concert, the two will go backstage to meet and greet the acts. Now, the stadium has worked very hard to prepare this little area. Today, they have had 7 men up here just to clean and paint it. Now, that's just a fraction of the effort that it has taken to get Live Aid to the stage here. Putting together a global jukebox is a lot of work.
Live Aid from London.
And here's another Live Aid update. There's going to be more headaches for the security organizers. Prince Charles and Princess Diana will arrive earlier at Wembley.
But I wanted to speak about Norway and Germany, which are still problems. I keep getting letters in the paper saying, well, it's all very well for him to do that, but can he not clean himself up before he goes on television?
Bob Geldof says that he has had very little time to do anything for himself lately, even work on his music, because for the past few weeks, he has spent up to 20 hours a day working on Live Aid.
It's going to be the biggest pop event ever. Can't wait to see it.
He didn't want to get involved in the ensemble. He sounded very hurt.
Tell me exactly what it has taken to get this effort going.
Grey hair and a grey beard and no sleep in one. At the end of the concert, enough juice will have been used at Wembley to provide a full week's Christmas lights in central London.
Electricity is one thing. Energy is another, and here in London, the staff has expended plenty.
In total, there's about 1,000 people be working from today onwards and on the day. Same in America. There's all the TV people, there's about 200. crews, graphic people, designers.
We've got 400 of the world's media all arriving at Wembley Stadium.
And my whole office has been turned upside down since then.
And they want to arrive and get an interview with every single person on that stage.
This week, the Live Aid workers were fending off the press and being pressed by the royal family's representatives to rearrange the opening ceremony. But according to promoter Harvey Goldsmith, compared with everything else going on, that was a minor problem.
Just dealing with the technology of how to dovetail two shows in, where everybody can see it, where we can show what's going on in Philadelphia over here and vice versa, and keeping the timings together, which is a nightmare.
Live Aid from London.
And here's another Live Aid update.
The effort is paying off already. At the Band Aid headquarters in London, food and clothing are pouring in, all as a result of people's awareness of Live Aid and its purpose. And they are expecting even more when the music hits the air.
Can't wait to see it and hear it.
When I see Philly and I see here and I see the concert in Sydney, because they're going for 12 hours before us, you kind of think, well, yes, indeed, it may have been hyperbole, but on this one day, indeed, we are the world. And on this one day, yes, indeed, we can feed the world.
By the way, in organizing this event, the members of the Band Aid Trust have decided that everyone should make a contribution. Even journalists who normally don't pay to come in and cover an event are paying for this. Newspaper people are being charged $135 each, and television reporters are being charged $1,000 to walk in here during the concert for 5 minutes and file a report. Well, that's it from here for now. Back to you, Ray and Judy.
Thanks, Nancy. You know that no one gets in free policy certainly applies to Philadelphia as well. Even the celebrities tomorrow will be asked to pay for everything they eat and drink.
And for anyone who's thinking of trying to sneak into this concert or present a counterfeit ticket, we wouldn't advise it. The security inside the stadium and outside of the stadium is going to be ultra tight.
When Countdown to Live Aid continues, we'll wrap things up from Philadelphia and London, and we'll meet a very special guest.
Hi, this is Joe, this is Tom, and I'm Alana. We're the Thompson Twins. Stay tuned, because in just a few moments, the Live Aid pre-concert special will continue.
It's more than just performing for us, I think, because the audience at the same time is walking down the same road with you. You're sort of elevated to a state of unselfishness, which I like. And I think we all want to share our blessings, and I think this is a good way to do it.
Well, as you've seen over the last hour, putting together something like the Live Aid concert is an overwhelming project, and one of the men responsible for that is with Judy Barton right now. Judy.
And the man is, I guess you could be considered the man of the hour, at least one of the men of the hour, promoter Bill Graham. Bill, you've been working up to this for several weeks now. What do you feel like inside? What does this mean to you emotionally?
It's down to fate now, really. I think we're as ready as we can be, and now we hope the planes land on schedule, that the streets will be clear enough for people to get through and the artists to get here, and that we can keep the schedule we have, so that we're fair to all the artists, and leaving room for the magic of improvisation, which hopefully will happen with the great talent that we have.
Can you give us any clue as to who might be improvising with whom and what we can expect tomorrow, maybe some surprises?
Well, we know for a fact that there are some firsts and one-time things. Jagger singing Without the Stones for the first time, playing with Hall & Oates and being joined by Tina. We have Teddy Pendergrass singing, coming in with Ashford & Simpson. We have Pat Metheny and Carlos Santana, two great guitar players. And then we will have, I wasn't certain a few days ago as to whether or not we would have some special friends joining us, and now I'm quite certain of that, so I feel good about that.
What special friends, Bill?
Oh, I guess we're going to find out, aren't we?
Yeah, we are, but can't you give us a clue?
No, not really. Some male and some female. How's that?
Okay, some male and some female. Yeah. Okay, that narrows it down at least.
Yeah.
All right, Judy, thank you very much. Let's go over to London now and wrap things up with Nancy Glass.
Ray and Judy, we are told that tomorrow night here at Wembley, there will be a surprise grand finale. A lot of top groups are getting together to sing a special song. We'll look forward to seeing that. Well, that's it from London. Back to you in Philadelphia.
All right, thank you, Nancy. You know, surprises may very well be the order of the day for Live 8. The finale here in Philadelphia is scheduled to be Bob Dylan singing Blowin' in the Wind, but you can be almost certain that he's going to ask several other performers to join him on stage.
It seems as if all systems are go for the Live 8 concert. You can hear the sound check going on right behind us.
You know, there's one thing we haven't talked about. What about the weather if it rains tomorrow?
Well, Ray, in the words of one of the promoters that I spoke to, no matter what the weather is tomorrow, he feels that the sun will be shining all over the world. I'm Judy Barton.
And I'm Ray Murray. Thank you for joining us, and have a good evening.
Good night.